have a few more people come in as we start going, so if you don't mind kind of squeezing in and going that way so that the empty chairs are closer to the aisle, that'll be less distracting. All right, I'm John Canty. I'm with Rocio Christi. And we have a treat for you this evening, just in time for having Easter conversations. Dr. Gary Habermas is Distinguished Research Professor of Apologetics and Philosophy and the Chair of the Department of Philosophy at Liberty University. He holds a PhD in History and Philosophy of Religion. He has authored over 40 books, over 100 articles, and has spoken at over 100 campuses around the world. He has debated some of the top atheists in the world, including the late philosopher Antony Flew. Antony was considered the most influential atheist philosopher in the 20th century. One of their public debates on the topic of the resurrection was in front of 3,000 people and had 10 formal judges, 5 philosophers to judge the content, 5 professional debate judges to judge debate technique. Of the 5 philosophers, 4 voted for Habermas, and 1 was undecided. And 3 of the professional debate judges voted for Habermas for technique and 2 for flow. But as impressive as that is, what I think is most interesting is that Dr. Habermas and Antony Flew were close personal friends. And I've only heard Dr. Habermas speak respectfully of Flew. What I think is, it's a beautiful thing when people can sincerely disagree and debate on fundamental topics, and yet do so with respect and love. Dr. Habermas is generally recognized as a leading authority on the historical Jesus and resurrection research. His talk tonight is on the evidence for the resurrection. Please welcome Dr. Gary Habermas.
I told him he just subtract one of the most important parts of my lecture, so we're going to have to, when we get there, some of you have heard this before, I'm going to have to take this off in order to make a little pilgrimage in the auditorium here. We'll see. I'm curious, anybody heard this lecture before, this resurrection timeline? How many have heard it more than once? How many have heard it more than twice? More than 3 times, more than 4 times, more than, you already won. How many?
John.
6 times.
6. Last time I gave this, I had a young lady in the crowd, she told me later, she said, you may not have seen me, but I had my hand up for 9 times and I lost. Somebody else beat her. Well, that doesn't mean it's popular or anything else. Let me tell you why people are seeing it. This lecture actually, let me tell you this first because you'll see the contrast. I teach full time in the PhD program. I teach only PhD courses. You might get, it's going to be heavy. No. This lecture I have given for a class in a school, a class of 11-year-olds. Bible students in a private high school. I gave it another time for a class of 14-year-olds in a history class. And I've given it at Oxford and Cambridge universities for PhD students and Oxford and Cambridge professors. Okay. The lecture is not difficult or hard or anything like that. It's that if you are familiar with historical arguments sometimes, there's a lot of puzzle pieces. There's a lot of jigsaw puzzles. And people come, I think, this is what they tell me over and over, they come because they would like to get it down so they can steal it. I had a guy tell me that this week. He said, I'm taking this to a group of 17 pastors this week. He's a minister. He said, I'm going to give it to 17 pastors. I know the guy really, really well. So I wrote back to him and I said, how dare you steal my material like that? And then my next sentence was, go ahead, I wish you well. I hope you do a good job. This is for multiplication. I've had people tell me, seriously, I listened to it 3 times, and then I did it for my Sunday school class. So that's cool. It's not complicated. It is detailed. Okay? So with that definition, the point I make right here at the beginning is that all history is created equal. There's no religious history and secular history. History's history. So when we start doing historiography, or the more technical field, philosophy of history, which field I work in, we have to talk in terms of what history is, what makes a good historical argument. I'm going to short circuit a lot of that discussion, and I'm going to say this. In history, there are certain tools and rules. The easiest way I can say this is, maybe a lot of you know my story, perhaps. I can't stand saying my first and second wife, but the wife of my children died of stomach cancer in 1995. I remarried. A new lady moves into the house. My kids are at the table. She never bothered anybody. She didn't say this any kind of challenging way, but my children were sitting at the table, and they were following their dad's example, and they were eating like this. And she looked over at one of my children, and she said, that's a fork. It's not a shovel. You know what I did? I went. She didn't even look down at my end of the table. She just said that. All right. That's like history. Historians have tools. And historians have rules to use the tools. And you don't use your forks like shovels. Now, for the historian, they have a lot of things to work with. They have sources. Usually written sources, but if it's more recent, let's say up until 100 years, you could have eyewitnesses, and that's real important. And we could have archaeology, and there's a place in this lecture where archaeology comes up, and it's a pretty good indication of when we know Paul came to Corinth, because we have an inscription in rock, a Greek inscription in rock. And then when you have the data that the tools bring, you just don't accept it at face value. You have to admit all data to criticism. So you apply critical techniques to the data. Now, those are tools, but with the rules, you start pulling out ways to use these, okay? And that's where it's a fork, it's not a shovel comes in. And there we have rules that I'm not going to be using a whole lot tonight, but I will take a couple things. Two of the most important kinds of rules for the historian are early and eyewitness sources are better than late and non-eyewitness sources, all things considered equal. You say, well, I know a case where eyewitnesses are wrong. You say, well, of course you do, but what do you want? Do you want real late ones with people who don't have a clue what's going on? Or if you want ones that are close with someone who was there. They can be wrong, but chances are they're a lot better than the other ones. So, I'm going to be concentrating on those two E's tonight, early and eyewitnesses, to see if we have that for the resurrection. Because as you'll see, there are critics, much more common a few decades ago, who would say the sources for the resurrection are late and non-eyewitness. And we'll see if we have anything to do with correcting that, okay? What kind of sources we have. And for those of you who are sitting there thinking, well, yeah, but there's a fundamental problem here. History doesn't deal with the supernatural. Sooner or later, you're going to get there, or your lecture's not going to be very useful. Well, if I don't get to that during the message, it depends on how I'm doing when I get to that point and how much of the 45 minutes we have left, if any, I might have to save that for the Q&A, but I won't ignore it. That question, very important question today. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk down here And I'm going to start a timeline. The rest of this lecture is about a timeline and the data with which you brought in. That's creation. I know I'm prejudiced. That's 2018. Way out that door, way past that wall. And we're dealing with just a 25-year window here, starting with the death of Jesus. I'm going to call it ground zero rather than a date. I'll tell you the date, but I'm going to say ground zero for two reasons. Number one, we go to and from this date to gather data. So I'm more interested in the to and from than I am the actual date. Secondly, scholars don't spend a lot of time on the date. There's a couple of different ways to do it. The most popular date for the death of Jesus is 30 AD. The second most popular date is not 29 or 31. The second most popular date is 33. And you have to get the moon right, the Passover right. This is Passover season. And that also means we know it's in the spring of the year. That's going to be important. One other point in this lecture. And so 30 or 33, well, which is it? Doesn't make any difference. Because we're dealing with early eyewitnesses. So if it's 33, we're just moving our dates now for the most part. And it's going to be the same number of years afterwards and so on. Now, some things will actually be an advantage if it's 33 because you're closer to the events. But for the most part, you're just moving dates down. All right. So this is the end of Jesus' life. He died by crucifixion, according to virtually every specialist who works in this area. You say, well, I know some people who don't think he died by crucifixion. Here's a Bart Ehrman. I mean, you're going to hear me use his name a lot. There's a reason. Bart Ehrman is the best-known skeptical New Testament scholar in North America. He's got a PhD from Princeton Theological Seminary. He's very well known, and he will tell you that any accredited New Testament scholar, no matter where he is religiously, Bart Ehrman says, I am not a Christian. I'm an agnostic leaning toward atheism, so don't get on my case. If I make a pro comment about Christianity, it's because I think the data are not there, not because I have a belief axe to grind. I don't have any of those. I'm not a follower of this. It's just my job to tell you what the data say. So I'm going to be relying him on a lot because he's not trying to get you to go to a church or hold to a certain view of theology or something else. All right, so I'm going to make a lot of use of that. Now, I'm going to talk about two ways to justify the life of Jesus, which will go that way from this point. What do we know about the historical Jesus? One way, if you ask the average Christian, how do you know anything about Jesus? The average Christian is going to say, well, let's talk about the Gospel of Mark. And I'm going to use critical dates, okay? Conservative dates are only just a little bit earlier, make no practical difference. So a critical scholar is going to say, Mark 65 to 75, average 70. 70 subtract 30 is plus 40. I knew you'd get that in a scientific school. Okay, so plus 40. Now Matthew is about plus 5 more, or 80 AD, or 50. Luke, at about, Luke's at the end of the row. You're going to take my word for it when I point to John a minute ago. Luke is 85, critical dating, or how many years after the fact? 55, and everybody puts John, you know, there's John. And you guys know that is his name, so. Yeah. So, John is about 95 AD. How old are you?
42.
Not 95. Not 65. He's 65 after that event. Hey, this was a plan. This is just cool. All right. John is about 65 years later. And we have a little more very crowd than when we had last night. We might have some people in here. I don't know. I'm looking around the crowd. I'm not trying to judge. I'm trying to judge anybody. But we might have some folks who remember things from 65 years ago. And they're really sure about these things. Because somehow maybe it's very important. Certainly there's no problem believing things. There are a lot of people in here, I'm sure, who remember things from 40 years ago. And in maybe a few rare cases, maybe it's your marriage. Maybe it's the birth of a child. And a famous University of Chicago scholar Paul Ricoeur says that there are unique events in people's lives, and they are more inclined to believe, to remember those than anything else. And at 40, this is fine. And we have people who can remember things for sure, remember things well at 65. They might forget other things at 65, but there's some things they'll remember. Like, I remember my grandparents, where my grandmother passed away shortly after their 70th anniversary. Now that's 70 years after marriage, not 70 years of life. But that would be a pretty special day for them. So, special dates count more than non-special dates, according to Ricoeur's theory. He's very influential. Okay, so I was debating an atheist one time when we were up on a platform like this one, and there were two pulpits. And I was in this one down here, and he was in that one down there. And he was pretty well known for getting ticked when it came to talk about any kind of religion, but especially Christianity. He was an atheist. And he said, the Gospels are lousy sources. They're late. And nobody can remember anything that happened 65 years after the date. That's just lousy history. And so I was trying to keep from being steamed. See, there's something about me. I used to be the ice hockey coach at Liberty University. I'm the head ice hockey coach. We have a special thing at Liberty because we have a lot of Canadians. And we play big schools like Duke and NC and NC State. And they're not used to Canadians going to the corner and coming up with the puck where they have three guys under one Canadian. And so, you know, there's advantages there. And sometimes during debates, you feel like going hockey on people. And this was one of those moments. And he said, how can somebody say we don't remember things after 40, 50, and 60 years? It's just untrue. But he had a chip on his shoulder. So I said, do you know much about Alexander the Great? And he said, yeah, a lot. His father was Philip of Macedon, Boy Wonder. Some people say it's the most unique combination of two geniuses in two different fields that ever lived. He's a military genius. Probably nobody liked him up until the time of at least Julius Caesar. And of course, his teacher in a different field was, somebody knows, Aristotle. Honey, get down here, Aristotle's here. And that was his schoolwork every day. Aristotle came. He trained his forces. He had the famous phalanx fighting method. He went east. He defeated the Persians. And he was off and running and conquered the world in his 20s. The known world. Special guy. Do we know a lot? Yes, he said. We know a lot. All right. I'll put my assistant up here. The Apostle John is coming up. All right. So, he said, we don't know anything from 40 to 65 AD. And I said, do you know when the first major text for Alexander has been written? He said, I do not. I felt like saying, I either felt like you should, or why do you make charges if you don't know what you're talking about? Right? Here's the earliest source for Alexander. Alexander dies. Here's the earliest source for Alexander on our timeline. Now you see why I needed my assistant. I'm not kidding you. I haven't measured it out, but oops. The earliest source for Alexander is just under 300 years after the fact. Just under 30 years. In fact, Alexander might have done that right there. I just saw that. I would have seen that if you weren't putting this thing in. Thank you. Now, that's 300 for the first major source. The best of the sources of Alexander is not 300. The two best sources for Alexander, Arian. even Plutarch. You got to kind of brace for this. 425 to 450. Oh, but crying out loud, 40 is way too late. Alexander at 450? Yeah, we got it. And the typical critical comeback was something like this. Yeah, but those were historians. Your sources are religious propaganda. Really? Well, it's a good thing the Greco-Roman historians didn't write any religious propaganda. Here's how Plutarch's Alexander starts, first two pages. It's commonly believed that Alexander was the son of a god and that his mother was a virgin. I love historical sources that don't have any theological proof. By the way, there's almost no Greco-Roman historians that didn't employ those sorts of events. You go, well then, that makes them all lousy. I'm thinking, boy, you should see the latest data on miracles before you make that judgment. I mean scientific cases today. That's a whole nother subject. But you can't say this is prejudiced and late when you have sources that are more than 10 times the distance of Jesus to Mark, and then say something silly like, they don't talk anything about, they're only doing straight history. First of all, there's no such thing as straight history. No such thing as straight anything. Because you have to have your findings and then someone's interpretation comes out. I love it when people who are otherwise very sharp and in fields don't realize that what they say about something is not part of the fact, it's their opinion about the fact. That's why somebody can be both a horrible dictator and a wonderful liberator, depending on whom you listen to their history. That's why. All right, this is the most typical way to do New Testament history. And you do the Gospels, and you're going to use reasoning like this. Now, I don't do it this way. I'm going to use a tighter argument. But before I do that, let me just make one other point. Some of you may have heard about a fragment in Mark that's been floating around. I've seen a few of you shake your head, yes. Been waiting for this for a long time. The dating hasn't come out. The reasons dating haven't come out. I'll explain that. It's a legal thing. Nothing to do with the provenance of the papyrus. The previous earliest copy of a gospel book we have is the writings fragment of John at about 125. It's very, very valuable because remember, early is a key historical sign. Writings only dates from about 25 or 30 years after the Gospel of John. I dialogued with a guy, true story. I dialogued with a guy years ago. He was a classical scholar. And he put the Gospels from 140 to 180 AD. Apparently nobody told him that when he put John at 170 AD, that we have a piece of John from 50 years earlier, but that didn't seem to bother him. Okay, so there's been a piece of Mark that we've been concerned about for a long time. We haven't come up with dates for legal reasons that could land you. There's this question about where this thing came from, not the provenance of it, not if it's it's a good piece of papyri. But you have to be careful where you pick things up, or you could be in jail because you have to register with Middle Eastern antiquities authorities, or they wonder what you stole that from. Okay, but one paleographer, I don't even think he's a Christian, but you have to be very specialized to be able to date ancient writings by handwriting analysis, by the type of handwriting. And a date was just given. I asked permission. Could this date be given? I was told it could be. And the date of this little papyrus from Mark is 80 to 110 AD. It is earlier than writings for John. So, if the fragment for Mark is about the time of John or earlier, now critics are saying we're going to have to move the Gospel of Mark back to 40 or 50 AD. What's that do to early eyewitness? Plus, there are two agnostic, one of them just passed away, unfortunately, but two agnostic New Testament scholars, neither one Christians, and they have recently, without reference to the fragment, have both dated Mark, one at 40 AD, one at 38 to 42 AD. This is good stuff. But I don't think it's the best argument for the historicity of Jesus. From this point on, I'm going to use a second argument that some of you may know I call the minimal facts argument. I sometimes call the lowest common denominator. Reliability arguments that say the Gospels are good, and if the Gospels are good, what they record is likely more trustworthy than not, are the most common species. But the minimal facts argument is tighter. It moves from the bottom up with one fact per brick. Let's put it that way. Think of bricks, and you're building a wall. And what if we can build a case for something, like the resurrection, with fewer facts than we think? Now, this is where I went. This is the, what I started developing in my dissertation at Michigan State. And believe me, you shouldn't hate Michigan State. We're all friends. We're in the Big Ten. I seriously pull for all Big Ten schools. And I'm saying this seriously. There's nobody, I don't know if there's anybody from Michigan State here, but if you guys win the basketball tournament, which you could, or if you win the Big Ten championship, I'll be pulling for you the big dance, because I want the Big Ten to do well. It's a serious comment. I thank all of you. It'd be a good game. Like, it was a very, well, the last game was solved by a shot, a three-pointer at the last second. Do you remember? Okay. I'm dead serious. We're in this together. I'm a Big Ten fan. Okay. We're on good grounds here. And it's a good school. It's like the second time I've been up here, and I'm really glad to come up here. I'm going to start using this bricks argument. And I developed this at Michigan State in my dissertation. And I thought, well, is there anything tighter than saying this is roughly reliable? And I thought, well, what if I could take data, which critics unanimously admit are so close to unanimous so as not to be a difference, like maybe in the 90-something percentile, And I'm not just taking what critics believe. Here's all they have to be is to qualify for my head count. Just be a scholar in New Testament or an appropriately close discipline. What would an appropriately close discipline be? Classics? History? Philosophy? A few other fields, perhaps. But New Testament or theology would be two. So it's pretty inclusive. Not only do I not care if you're a Christian scholar or not, I actually prefer dealing with atheistic, agnostic, non-Christian, otherwise non-Christian, New Testament scholars. Why? People question them less. They're just as fair with the data. And they'll prove to you that not everybody chooses things just because they like the facts, or that it works with them. So I'll be referring to a lot of names tonight, like Bart Ehrman, who are skeptical, or like some of the Jewish New Testament scholars. They're Jewish, not Christians, with PhDs in New Testament. That's fantastic. I'll use those. And what I say is, here's some facts that fulfill two qualifications. Qualification number one, this is by far the most important one. I will use no fact that is not multiply attested by a number of other facts. And secondly, because it's so well attested, virtually everybody writing on the subject concedes it, no matter what their personal views. Now, the second one could change tomorrow. Something could come through, and everybody who gets it now could have political reasons. You all know how, I don't even mention politics today, and the DC swamp, and et cetera. And then you just have to know who's on which side, you know who's gonna get mad at who. It's a tough time. But if things can happen like that in politics, it can happen like that in history. You can have people choose other side because of prejudice or other reasons. So, of the two rules, I would much rather have critics give up on the facts tomorrow. They would still have to deal with the data. And I haven't done this for ages, but I just put together a PowerPoint recently. I don't know why I've done this. Probably because nobody makes you do this, because everybody concedes the data I'm going to use. But I settled down, I thought, what would it be like if I evidenced a half dozen of these facts, which I think are sufficient enough to show that the resurrection of Jesus occurred, and everybody's on board with them? So I put together a PowerPoint with how many facts come in to support just these six. And there's many more than what I put in this PowerPoint. But the PowerPoint has 64 historical arguments for just six facts. That's an average of just short of 11 facts, 11 backup points per fact. That is huge in the ancient world. That's why nobody debates them. Well, I know a guy who debates them. I know a guy who says Jesus never lived. Okay, good. Does he live in a basement and run a blog and call himself a published scholar? But I'm not picking, I don't have anybody in mind. I'm just saying sometimes this generation is such that the guys who have the least credentials are the guys who talk the loudest and think, you know, they can say whatever they want. And here comes mom with the dirty clothes while they're writing that in. He's a scholar. Bart Ehrman says that if you only count scholars who have good, reputable degrees in a relevant New Testament field, he says he knows two scholars who believe Jesus never lived. Two. And none who hold accredited positions, who hold positions in accredited colleges, universities, or seminaries. None. That's why I don't mind what these people believe, because largely scholars, careful scholars, are fair with the data, even if it doesn't favor their view. Alright. So I put much more emphasis on many evidences backing up each fact. But it's an accident. In philosophical terms, I don't mean like a car accident. It's an accident. It's accidental that everybody's on board because the data are so good. So I'll just put that one in there too, because it's a good consideration. But the more important one is that there's backup roles. I'll just remind you that backup point. Paul Meyer, emeritus professor of ancient history, not too far up the road here from you at Western Michigan University, Paul Meyer says, most facts in the ancient world are determined by one, evidence, and two, often make an event impregnable. An average of 11 for six. Or let's take Bart Ehrman. How do we know Jesus was crucified? Bart Ehrman gives a list of 15 independent sources for the crucifixion of Jesus, all within 100 years of the cross. And that's his date, but 100 years in the ancient world, 100-year margin is fair. And he's the agnostic, leaning toward atheism. So, 15 sources for the crucifixion. All right, so I'm going to argue. I'm going to start here today with the critics' darling, the Apostle Paul. Now, there's 13 books in the New Testament that bear Paul's name. Let me explain something about these 13, about New Testament in particular. There's such an easy fact that I often have to explain it to even my PhD students maybe five times. Not because they're stupid, but because the point is so easy, they just assume it's more complicated than it is, and they're looking for the... But here's how it works. Critics, the guys who blog in their parents' basement, and I know I wasn't being fair, but I get frustrated. They're the ones that if you talk about New Testament and you go, well, I have four New Testament sources, they'll say, prejudice, can't use any New Testament sources, they're all prejudice. The scholars don't say that. No specialist says that. Probably none. None. Atheist? None. Agnostic New Testament? None. Jewish New Testament? None. They don't say it. Here's what they'll say. If it meets criteria, like, well, if you have early an eyewitness, that's extremely rare. Yeah, that's fantastic. But they have other rules on how to use tools. They have other rules. And if it meets other ones, like enemy attestation, or embarrassment, or, you know, and the list goes on, Aramaic substrata. There's about 20 of these that they use for application. You're good to go if you've got several of them. The fact that you're using from the New Testament is irrelevant for non-Christian New Testament scholars. I seriously mean that. Irrelevant. In fact, for Bart Ehrman, if you don't use verses, he will. And a lot of them. What's he doing? Well, I don't know. If there's a biologist in here, somebody correct me if I'm wrong in this, but even if I'm wrong, just picture it being right. I don't know, but it seems to me I heard somewhere that spiders weave webs and know which strands to run on so they don't get caught in their own stuff. I don't know if that's true. But here's the New Testament scholar's point. It's not that you can't use any verses. Just know which ones are well evidenced. They're the ones you can run on or run with. Take the facts which are well evidenced. We don't care who said them. If they're well evidenced. Now sometimes you gotta kind of curb your enthusiasm. If you're a Christian and something looks good, you gotta be careful. Go overboard or something. But don't be afraid to use data if it's well evidenced, no matter who the source is. Especially if it's early evidence. Okay, I've said enough. Oh, Paul, back to Paul, 13 books. Critics will let you use 7 of them. 7. Interestingly, they always give you the same 7. They always give you the same 7. And here they are. Romans. 1 and 10 Corinthians. Galatians. Philippians. 1 Thessalonians. And a little one chapter, Philemon. They always let you use those 7. You go, what do you mean they always let you use them? They're inspired or something? No, they don't believe any of those books are inspired. See, that's another thing that blows Christians' minds. They think you have to have inspiration to have meaning. And these guys would say, no, they're not inspired. But Paul is a trustworthy guy. You go, really? You believe that? Yeah, he's trustworthy. What's trustworthy mean? Well, he's authoritative. What's authoritative mean? Inspired? No way. Well, why do you use him? Well, if the book of Acts is to be trusted, he studied under Gamaliel, the foremost Old Testament scholar. That would be like Bart Ehrman's mentor being Bruce Metzger at Princeton, the best-known Greek scholar of his generation. Oh, by the way, Bruce Metzger was a committed Christian. Does that keep critics from saying he was the best Greek scholar in the world? Absolutely not. Everybody cites Bruce Metzger. There's another one of those examples. So, Paul is a scholar. He did a, basically say he got a PhD in the Old Testament, or the top Old Testament guy in the world at that time. Okay, what else? He knows how to argue. How do you know? As my atheist buddy that was already mentioned, Tony Flew, said, he said, Paul was a first-rate, he said this in his atheist days. Tony became a theist late in his life. He said, Paul is a first-class philosophical mind. And you say, how do you know that? He said, my golly, read the book of Romans. Now, you know what he meant by that? He meant the man can make an argument. Just read the way he writes and how he puts an argument together. He's a first-class thinker. All right, PhD, you know, roughly, under the major Old Testament guy at that time, first-class scholar, very careful. He would not lie to you. We know a lot about his character from these books. Now, he could be wrong, the critics would say, but he won't lie. So he's not going to mislead you purposely. He's just a good man. And most importantly, critics don't think we know who wrote the Gospels. There's a lot of disagreement there. But they don't usually say that. But they say that Paul wrote these 7 books. So we know the author. All right, now what do we have if we plug Paul into this? Instead of going this way, we go this way. I'm only going to use 2 texts. 1 Corinthians 15, the end of Galatians 1, beginning of Galatians 2. That sounds like 2 texts, but the original is 1 text. The chapter divisions were added later. All right. So, 1 Corinthians 15, Paul gives the gospel to the Corinthians, and he says, when I came to you, Corinthians, I gave you the gospel. Now, footnote. What's the gospel? There's 2 sides of the gospel. Facts of the gospel, what people are called to do if they want to be followers of Jesus. All right, the first side, facts of the gospel, always mentioned in context when the gospel is defined. Deity, death, resurrection of Jesus. Deity, death, resurrection. Sometimes it's called, it's resurrection, death, deity. You know, like Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, deity, and believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, so resurrection went before death, that's the way he's making the theology. Is he going to be saved? For Paul says, what you do with that determines whether or not you're a Christian. It's the first 2 verses of this chapter, 1 Corinthians 15. What have you done with Jesus? Then he starts in verse 3. Super simple, but super important. And he starts like this. I gave you, I passed on to you what I received. I'll stop and I'll just say, you all get that? Yeah, there's not much to that. I heard you. No, listen. I gave you what I was given. You go, hey, I'm in grad school. I can get that. Okay. No, listen. Listen to the significance of this. I gave you what I was given. Okay, you're passing on tradition. Yes. What does Josephus tell us? Pharisees taught by passing down tradition. Today, seven laws of teaching, the famous teaching book. Good teachers repeat themselves. Okay, I can handle that. And Paul says, I gave you what I received. Those Greek words in 1 Corinthians 15 are technical Aramaic terms. They're the equivalent of technical Aramaic terms for receiving and passing on tradition. Josephus said, that's what the Pharisees do. And Paul said in Philippians 3, one of the trusted books, I'm a Pharisee. So he's passing on tradition. Wow. You mean he didn't come up with this on his own? Nope, he got it from somebody else. What do you mean in history? Among other things, early eyewitnesses. Do we have that? You judge. So Paul says, I gave you what I was given. Where and from whom did he get this material? Now, the book is written, if anything, a little late, 25 years later, at about 55 AD. Most scholars today, critical scholars in particular, are leaning toward about 53, if that makes a big difference, plus 23. Paul told the Corinthians, this is what I gave you when I came. When did he come? 51 to 52. How do we know? Because the New Testament gives us the name, we call him the mayor, but that's not what the Greeks call him. The city manager, we have a name written down in stone that dates to 51 to 52. Here's the cool thing. These guys only had 1 year appointments. So we know that if he was the one when Paul came, and his time runs from 51 to 52, now we know when Paul came to Corinth. And he said, I gave you this when I came. Now we're down to 21 to 22 years. All right, same question. When and from whom did he get this material? Consensus today. Consensus view, I don't care if you get it from the critics or if you get it from the Christians. Consensus view. Paul received this material about plus five. Plus five? Yeah. And the best we can do on Alexander is plus 280? Yeah. Well, not the best. The earliest we can do on Alexander is plus 280? Yeah. And the best we can do on Alexander is plus 4 1/4 to 450? Yeah. And what's this again? Plus five. Would you please do the math for me? I will. Whenever you call the cross, 30 or 33, it's ground zero. When does Paul, according to his own testimony, when does he say he met the risen Jesus on the way to Damascus? When does that event in Acts 9 take place? Another way to ask this is, how soon after Acts 1 does Acts 9 occur? Critical scholars say Paul had that experience at either plus 1, plus 2, or plus 3. Average. Plus 2. All right. Jesus dies. Whatever happened to Paul on the way to Damascus happened at plus 2. And in Galatians chapter 1, nobody questions this actual Pauline book. It's admissible. Paul says, I didn't go running up to Jerusalem to meet those who were apostles before me. I went around the Middle East, and I don't know, some people think he preached, some people think he just studied. Whatever. But he said, I went to Jerusalem 3 years later. All right, y'all with me? Ground zero. Paul has his trip to Damascus, plus 2. 3 years later, he went to Jerusalem. 2 plus 3, 5. 35 AD, he's there. And he says, Galatians 1:18, he said, I spent 15 days in Jerusalem, and I saw none of the other apostles except two. Guess who they were? Peter and James, the brother of Jesus. Whoa. If I had picked two, I'm pretty sure those would be the two I'd pick. And they were there. He spent 15 days with them. One famous Cambridge University professor, C.H. Dodd, last generation, C.H. Dodd said, Paul spent 15 days with Peter and James. And, oh well. 15 days with Peter and James. And it's safe to do, no, it's safe to say that he did more than talk about the weather. What would you do if you had 15 days with Peter and James? Bart Ehrman calls this one of the two most important arguments for the historicity of Jesus. Bart Ehrman says this, agnostic lean toward atheism. And he says this. He goes, Paul spent 15 days with Peter and James. Pause. I'd like to spend 15 days with Peter and James. And then he says, because he doesn't believe we know the authors of the Gospels, Ehrman says, this is as close as we come to eyewitness testimony in the New Testament. Now, y'all follow me? What are the most important two rules? Early and eyewitness. How do you know George Washington's the first president of the United States? Hopefully you have early and eyewitness data. And what does Paul have? He was there at plus five, talked to Peter and James, but talked about the gospel. That's what the whole book of Galatians is about. Short book. What's the nature of the gospel? And they told him right here. Plus five. Sure beats Alexander. Now, is chapter one of Galatians ends, and I told you it runs right into two because there's no divisions. Paul says, 14 years later, I went back up to Jerusalem. Now, critics put this in about 48 AD, or just plus 18. Probably almost everybody here, or at least many, many, many of you can remember things from 18 years ago. And this one happens 18 years ago, and he said, I went back up to Jerusalem, and I set before the disciples, the apostles, the gospel I was preaching, to see if I was running in vain. A what? Yeah, I decided to lay the gospel on the table to make sure we're all teaching the same message. That's cool. That's what a researcher does. You know who was there? Paul, of course. Peter's still there. James is still there. And this time, John is there. Nobody, nobody, nobody is more influential in the early church than Paul, Peter, James, and John. By the way, I do not think we can prove that all the apostles suffered deaths as martyrdom, but of these four guys, three of them, we have first century data for their martyrdoms. And the only one that a lot of Christians think wasn't martyred, John, we have a second century data for his martyrdom. That's special too. But he meets here at about plus 18. Now, I said a moment ago, this sounds like good historical investigation. Guess what? When Paul goes to Jerusalem at plus 5, he uses a Greek word in Galatians 1:18. And it's hystereisai. The root word is the word from which, Greek word from which we get our English word, history. And the Greek alphabet's not the same as the English alphabet, but if you transliterate it into English, the root word for hystereisai is histor. H-I-S-T-O-R. You know what it means in the ancient world, in papyrus? It means to check things out firsthand. Don't rely on somebody else. It's actually used, for example, in the geographers checking on a river. Where's the bend? Where's the deep water? Where's the shallow water? Where do I portage my canoe? Where's the town? Where's the rock bluff? And how far am I from the next town? Well, go check it out. I'll check it out myself and I'll keep a diary instead of asking what people know from this area. That's his store. And Paul said, I went up to Jerusalem to do the work of his store, to check things out firsthand with Peter and John. And later, Peter and James. And later, John is here. Now, almost done. This is when Paul received the material. We can do better than this. Paul got the material, critics think, consensus New Testament position. Paul got this material in Jerusalem, it's believed, from Peter and James. But if they gave him this material, they had it before he had it. Fair? How long before? I don't know. A year? 18 months? I don't know. But he comes at plus five. They give him their testimony. Now, this one might take some explaining if somebody wants to pursue it during the questions. But In the New Testament, there are dozens of early passages called creeds, and this is the most exciting development in early research. It's the answer to the question of what did earliest preaching consist before we had our first New Testament book. How do you know? Well, I don't know. Maybe you just cite 1 Corinthians. Yeah, but that's 20 years later. I mean, it's fine. That's great. Plus 20 is fantastic. But how do we know what they were preaching? The creedal passages are short, usually staccato, little texts. Short, da-da-da-da-da-da-da in the Greek. Often they're hymns. Now, scholars today, sociologists, first century sociologists say that perhaps 70% of Jesus' audiences were illiterate. Well, that's kind of a problem. How do you write this material? Well, not everybody's illiterate. Paul was a Pharisee, he was trained. But let's talk about the sources here. You can be illiterate and sing five verses of Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound, and not be able to sign your name. So those who could read and write would teach others by doing it in da-da-da-da-da-da-da prose, or narration, poetry, or music. We have a song in, usually believed, in Philippians 2, another one in Colossians 1, early hymns. But that's how they did things for people who didn't know, and they passed around creeds. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 follows an early creed. It's probably the most unanimous conclusion in the New Testament. I don't care who you're getting it from. Get it from atheist to Testament scholar. That's great. It's an early creed. Dated from when? Well, this is when Paul got it. Peter had it first. But even for those who had the testimony first, it takes a while to put it in da-da-da-da-da-da form. Well, wait a minute. We're right on top of the data. Exactly. How old is this material? Well, maybe Bart Ehrman helps us. He said, not a Christian. Don't care. I'm an agnostic. I hear now he calls up an atheist. I don't know if that's true or not. It's hearsay. But Bart Ehrman says the latest this report could be in the dot form, the latest it could be is 1 to 2 years after the cross. That's the latest. 1 to 2 years. Alexander, 280. Good stuff. 4 to 450. Paul, 1 to 2. Early, early, early. And Paul uses the word hysteresi for passing on material and research in the first hand. Bart Ehrman says this is the best indication we have of historicity of Jesus. And what's reported? The gospel. What's the gospel? Deity, death, resurrection of Jesus. Well, then why don't these skeptics who grant these facts accept it? Well, let me ask you guys a question. How many Philadelphia Eagles fans? I've never done this before in this lecture, but it seems appropriate. How many of you are Philadelphia Eagles fans in football? One. If they're the best team in football, I know you disagree with that, but if they're the best team in football, how come all of you didn't become a what? Oh, you're prejudiced? Oh, you're from another city? Yeah. That's not your age group? Could be. They're not your favorite players? Yeah. You hate football? Oh, yeah. But Philadelphia Eagles are the best, right? No, I saw one hand. We have other reasons for accepting conclusions. Oh, what did you vote? Oh, and why did you? I didn't know who that other guy's name, but I didn't know how to spell it. I just told this was the guy to vote for, so I did. That's who we are. That's who we are as people. And we make decisions based on things other than, usually, according to stats, we make decisions on things other than the facts. The question is, why are there so many who believe this is true? But don't say, well, then why Bart Ehrman is not, why is he not a Christian? He says he walked away from Christianity because of pain and suffering. Well, I'll deal with that if you want during the Q&A, but let me just say something. Becoming an atheist or a Christian does not solve the problem of pain and suffering. We all hurt just as much. I just told you something. My wife and my four children died at the age of 43 of stomach cancer in 1995. Right? The old saying, you can make lemons out of that, or you can make lemon pie, or lemonade. A lot of things you can do with lemons. A lot of things you can do with facts. But you have to answer the data. Don't tell me you don't like it. Don't tell me it's not your party. Don't tell me it's not your football team. You got to make do with the data. And I think this data is very impressive. And please, somebody say it during the Q&A. Someone say, but you're asking us to believe supernatural events. Well, first of all, I don't remember calling a supernatural event a single time. I don't do that. Well, come on, a resurrection would be supernatural. Probably. But the fact is, I went all the way through it. I didn't say that. There's other ways to get there. But you have to make account of this data. It's way better than Alexander's. Way better. People don't question it. Well, yeah, because that's the history. Well, we've already gone over that. And by the way, for those of you who are thinking, Alexander's mother was a virgin? You know, I'm not believing that, but did Christians copy off that? No, Alexander dies in the 320s AD, but Plutarch doesn't write that. To show you how late it is, he doesn't write it until about 120 AD, almost 100 years after Jesus died. Now, who got what about the virgin birth from whom? I'm not saying they did copy. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying don't tell me it's the other way around. Well, the guy didn't write for 120. That's Plutarch. Okay, so in conclusion, I think a lot of things can be said here. Let me just name one. But I'll tell you what, real quickly, let me tell you two things that are practical results of resurrection. One I just mentioned, problem of suffering. To this day, I don't know why my wife died at the age of 43. Most precious person in the world, I told my friends who called me and say, how you doing? I'd say, God is still good, but the worst possible thing in my life has happened to me. I buried my wife, my best friend. I don't know why. Now, if I knew, would it change it? No. She's still buried. Do I really want to know? No. Because what would wanting? I'm not sure I want to know. It doesn't change anything. Do atheists struggle just as much with evil? Just as much. With any purpose? No, according to their own word, none. It might be personal preference. But not ultimate. They don't believe in ultimate objectivity. They still got to deal with it. Here's my second response. If all I know is that Jesus has been raised from the dead, Son of God died on the cross, raised from the dead, with very early sources. You get all those from right back there. If that's all we knew, what if I couldn't answer the problem of evil or why my wife died? What if I can't answer the so-called genocide passage in the Old Testament? What if I can't answer whether Judas hung himself or fell down the side of a cliff and died? Does that change anything? Not ultimately. Why not? Because every one of you, this is a research institution. Every one of you, when you go to a library or online to get a source, you know your biography of George Washington is not inerrant. Oh, you're using Smith's book? Some Smith has to have written a book, I'm sure. You're using Smith's book? Don't you know that they proved there's 22 major errors in that book? Yeah, but the sources also say it's a pretty good source, so I used it. See, we're used to using sources that have issues. Because none of us know major sources that don't have issues. So if all I know is that Jesus, Son of God, died across your sins, rose from the dead, guess what? Christianity's true. Yeah, but what about genocide? Christianity's true. What about Jesus? Christianity's true. What if the Gospels are not as like? Christianity's true. What's the only Gospel authors who? Christianity's true. Because I'm picking the things that determine it. You go, well, how many, don't care if there's different things? Look, go to the Zondervan website and the University website. You're going to find something like 100 titles by Christians of 3, 4, and 5 used books. Christians love those things. They stay in print. They debate which doctrine is true. But do you think if another doctrine that's not mine turns out to be right? I'm not a Calvinist. Sorry. If you are, you don't change my view of the gospel. It's fun to debate. Oh, what do you believe about creation? Oh, that's not my view. Oh, who's wrong? Does it change the gospel? No. Okay, let's move on. I'm only concentrating the gospel tonight, and it doesn't change. So what's at the end of the yellow brick road? The gospel. The Emerald City. Why? Because the resurrection is about afterlife. There's some of you think, yeah, but you're going over a crucial line here. You're bringing the supernatural to Israel. Please say that to me during the Q&A. And I won't quote Alexander to you again about Son of Gods and virgins. I won't quote that. I'll go a different way with an empirical path that opens the road to eternal life. I'd like to. But whether we get there or not, it's in the matter. All right, let me stop right here. My conclusion is, resurrection happened because there's multiple evidences for every fact I use. And this is just for fun, it's free. 90-something percent of all the scholars writing, believers or unbelievers, can state every one of these facts. I think that's the definition of a good bit of data. And if you could just roll with me right now with the punches, if there's potentially an afterlife, to me, that's the last door being knocked down here. And you're confronted flat with this. But if this lecture tonight were 15 reasons you'd be a Philadelphia Eagles fan, I wouldn't be surprised if nobody changes their vote. Because that's who we are. Where do you live? Who are you married to? North? South? Do you like football? Do you? Who'd you vote for? I don't know. Who do you vote for? That's how we make our average decisions. Not by, give me 42 empirical evidences. We don't make our decisions that way. So, stay on the topic. We can solve other problems later. But if you have comebacks to this, I'd like to hear. John, are you going to introduce the next section, or I just go right in? Here comes the gospel himself.
Here's my big introduction. We're going to have a Q&A now.
Thank you very much. I'm glad I didn't give you the microphone if you needed it. All right, who'd like to get us started? If the questions are really, really tough, I'll be leaving in about like 5 minutes. Yes.
Thanks for coming, Dr. Habermas. I've recently been listening to a podcast called Hinge about proving the resurrection of Christ. And one thing that the atheist host, there's an atheist and a Christian, he says when they lay out all the facts is that the Christian has just proved that people believe, early and eyewitness sources believe
excellent.
There was a resurrection. Would you mind speaking into that?
That's an excellent objection. In fact, I go to my PhD students and say, let's just say for this, Richard Carrier says about mine, I start with a larger list of 12, which I cut down to the shorter list of 6. Richard Carrier basically says, I'm okay with Habermas's 12 facts, except I don't allow the empty 2. Well, you notice I didn't use it, because it's not one of my mental facts. But I will tell you this, there's more evidence that's critically ascertained, more for the empty tomb than are for any of the others. Why don't I use it? Because it's not agreed to by 95% of scholars. How much? How many? Well, when I went to school, only about 25% of scholars believe in the empty tomb. Today, that number's gone way up to about 75%. But how do you know? Whenever someone says, how do you know? I have a quick little answer. I counted. Have you? And that's German, French, and English sources. So, go take your German, French, and English test. So I didn't use the empty tomb. And he thought the other 11 were okay. Now, I already answered the one question, why doesn't a Richard Carrier believe? Because he doesn't want to. Now, there's a certain amount, well, how about you Christians? There's a certain amount in which Christians believe because they want to. That's fair. We believe and don't believe for other reasons. That's called interpretation or preference. Or who'd you vote for? Who's your favorite football team? That's the point I was trying to get across. But if you only, let's ask it this way. Who's in the better grounds? Okay, now this question comes along, and someone like a Richard Carrier, I'm soon going to say to me, well, let me just use an actual case. A current leader, an agnostic New Testament scholar, an unbeliever, named James Crossley, British, PhD New Testament. We had a dialogue. You can find this on Unbelievable. We were both present in the studio in London. And the topic was this. Do the minimal facts successfully argue for the resurrection of Jesus? Something like that. And the moderator said, Gary, how many facts did you use today? Well, see, I changed the number. You go, I changed the number. Because nobody only gives me 6. I'm using such a small number. I mean, it's kind of fun to do this. The hardest core guys like Rudolph Bultmann might give me 20. So to say 12, I'm way below. But when I go 6, here's what I feel like saying to them. Only six? Yeah, I'm a pretty liberal guy. You know, people don't think of conservative Christians as being pretty liberal, but I take away less facts than they do. So I change my numbers sometimes depending on who I'm talking to, because nobody only gives me that low number, just in case you're wondering why you change your numbers. All right, he said, Gary, what do you use today? I said, six. He said, what are they? Jesus died during the crucifixion. The disciples, you got it right, disciples had experiences that they believed were principles. You see what Bart says about that? He said, of course I can see that point, that the disciples had experiences that they believe were principles. Jesus, why wouldn't I? And I would never use this word, but Bart Ehrman says, it's proven by history. Woo-hoo. That's pretty conservative. Bart, where'd you get that conservative theology? Okay, he says, proven by history. Three, they turned the world upside down and were willing to die. Now, some we can say they were. You go, a lot of people are willing to die today. That's right, but here's the difference. Watch this closely. Here's the difference. Today, anybody for a religious or political scheme who dies willingly for what they believe, that's what's required. Try to, you know, find somebody who dies willingly for what they know is false, and they're sane. Try to find an example. And there might be one or two, but in all of history, come on, they're just really, really rare. People die for what they believe to be true. But there's the key again, believe to be true. And I'll come right back to that. Okay, fourth one, proclaim. The point about dying, being willing to die. The disciples are the only ones in the world who know whether they died, what they died for is true or false. See, today, no matter what religion, Muslim, Christian, a communist, atheist, maybe, who died for a class of society. I'm sure it happened, and they really believed it. So people die for what they believe in. But the disciples today, anyone who dies, dies for their religion's special beliefs and their political special beliefs. But the disciples didn't just die for their beliefs. They're the only ones who knew if they really saw Jesus or not. Today we believe they saw Jesus. They say we saw Jesus, and we saw him in singly and in groups. This is a whole other point. I don't want to get too far, but the Jesus seminar, the guys who reject up to 90% of the red letter words of Jesus, they give you multiple sources for group appearances of Jesus that doesn't work on hallucinations. If you're interested, a recent medical history going back, a recent clinical psychological history going back, there's not one case in medical or psychological history of a certified appearance hallucination to a group of people. And you've got to believe it happens over and over and over again if you believe the facts. I mean the report. Report of facts. Alright, fourthly, very, very early, oh, I didn't even tell you, I just realized this. Bart Ehrman said 1 to 2 years. James D.G. Dunn, more influential than Bart Ehrman. James D.G. Dunn says that material was around months after the cross. Months. Hurtado, Larry Hurtado, Edinburgh, says days. Early. Did you spell early? Days. Okay, so it's very early. Then you have two skeptics, James and Paul, who became believers when they thought they saw the risen Jesus. Now the question is, how do you get, what are the facts saying they believed they saw? James, Paul really believed and they had experiences. Four of them say they really believed. How do you get from they really believed who they really saw? You can pull this one off, it's over. Everybody allows they really saw, because they believe they saw, because the Bart Ehrman's world is provable. How do you get from really saw to really saw? Here's the key. Can you think of an alternative thesis that explains the data better? If you can't, you're in trouble. Now, I've debated guys who won't pick theories. And Bart Ehrman's latest move is, he said, I'm not going to pick a theory. Now, he says in one of his latest books, Bart Ehrman says, history cannot prove the resurrection of Jesus. Well, I don't expect him to say it can. He's not a Christian. History can't prove the resurrection of Jesus. You know, there's a comma there. You know what the rest of the sentence is? And history cannot disprove it either. I didn't expect that from Bart Ehrman. When I read it, I went, what? I know he doesn't believe it, but he didn't think you can disprove it. But if you've got all the data on your side, and 10-plus evidences, facts, supporting each one, and no counter theories. Wow, things are getting a little tight. And I've had critics say to me in debates, I'm not picking one of your naturalistic theories. Well, they're not mine, they're yours, you're the naturalist. So I'm not picking a naturalistic theory. I go, why not? I'll tell you my secret, I'm a supernaturalist. I believe Jesus is raised from the dead. You're a naturalist, why don't you pick a naturalistic theory? Ain't gonna do it. I had one guy actually say this to me in a debate. Because I'll pick one, you'll get me in the corner, I won't be comfortable, and I don't like it. He said that. And when I pressed him, I said, come on, you're naturalist, pick one. You know what he said? He got mad. He got really mad. And he said, he was chewing on a pipe. And I told this group yesterday, all the signs around the building, around the room said, no smoking, no smoking, no smoking, no smoking, he was smoking a pipe. He didn't just hold it there, he was smoking it. And you know people talk when they're biting the pipe? He's biting the pipe and he goes, Habermas, you're making me angry. I don't like it. And as far as I'm concerned, this debate is over. And it was over. He didn't say anything else. Because I only asked him to pick a theory. He goes, no, you're going to try to pin me down. Duh! Try to pin me down to a theory within your own philosophy. All right, so there's the key. Pick a naturalistic theory that works. Now, here's Barnum's comeback. I'm not going to. Why not? Because any theory is better than resurrection because miracles don't happen. Really? Who said that? Your mother or you? Who said miracles don't happen? Well, everybody knows that. Really? How would you like a theory? Okay, let me give you a political example and a football example. This is what I think they're doing, naturalists. Here's a political example. We can't have another election until my candidate is 10 votes short of the number we need for president. Now, should we go vote as a country, or you can let this one vote? That's my requirement before we vote. I have to have all the electoral votes except 10. No, that's not fair. Football example. Okay, who's going to play next year? Let's say the Eagles play. The Eagles aren't my team, by the way. Eagles play New England next year. All right, I'm not going to let them play unless it's 42-0 Philadelphia. Now, let's kick off. Who tipped the tables? Somebody who's cheating. Why do naturalists say, no, I'm not cheating. Miracles don't happen. You show me where they happen. I will. You know where miracles are? Now, I'm just going to give you a couple real quick examples, but there's only one I want to mention. Not one miracle, but one species. How many of you have seen, in fact, I think you've had him here. You got Craig Keener here?
Yeah.
How many of you have seen Craig Keener's two-volume, whatever it is, 1,186 pages of contemporary miracles? How many of you know these two books? These are collections from all around the world, so much so that he identifies the miracles by geographical distribution. South American miracles, Central American miracles, North American miracles, European miracles, African miracles, Middle Eastern miracles, Far Eastern miracles. And Craig's not an apologist. He doesn't try to make an argument work. But I went through his two volumes and came up with his best cases, what I think are his best cases. And here's just one or two. Whenever you have a critic who's making fun of miracles, one of the things they say is, show me a limb that grows back. That's like their favorite. Is there some reason this is? Is it real bad or not?
There's a little ringing.
All right. Well, tell me if it gets bad and I'll keep going. Here's one of them. A little girl was going in with a clubbed foot and she was having surgery. The orthopedic surgeon was there. The pastor says, can I pray one more time? Surgeon says, okay, but we have to do this. So the pastor prays. And the orthopedic surgeon specialist says, I was cheating. I opened my eyes during the prayer. And the surgeon said, I saw her foot opened. And needless to say, we didn't do surgery. What if there were 100 of those in the book, 100 stories like that? I can tell you a number of others. Here's one. A little baby had a diseased kidney. You can't say it's faith healing. It was a little, very little baby. And the baby had to have a kidney removed. They took the kidney out. Church is praying. They take the baby in for the post-op checkup. They do whatever test they do, MRI test, to check, and the baby has two kidneys. But there's a scar there. They have a record of the kidney coming out. There's stitches. And the baby has two kidneys. I'm just saying, what do you do when you have some of these? Double-blind prayer tests. I did this once, and a very famous atheist got upset with me. You know most of those things are fake. Yes, they are. As far as I know, there's only two that have worked. Double-blind prayer, both written up in peer-reviewed medical journals. It's not my fault that the prayers, not the prayees, but the prayers in both cases were Orthodox Christians. That's not my fault. Now, let me be real clear. I think God heals non-Christian believers. Jesus never went to towns and did this. Believer, you're not? You're healed. You're not. It says he healed everybody. God's an equal opportunity healer. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying it's not my fault that the only two that work were Christian prayers. But what do you do with those two? They're written up in peer-reviewed medical journals. You get the data. All right, other examples I can give you besides healing and prayers. Today, the field, even the Jesus Seminar guys, they've changed. When I went to school, critics did not believe Jesus was a miracle worker. Today, I'm using the critics' testimony, 100%. This is their figure. They give the figure. It's probably not that high. I mean, it's probably like a mere 94. That's still an A, by the way. About 100%, according to them, now today believe that Jesus did miracles. What's happened? To cite a very famous Jesus Seminar co-founder who passed away a few years ago, Marcus Borg, famous name if you study these names. Marcus Borg said, I don't know what your views are on miracles, but on historical grounds alone, it is virtually impossible to deny that Jesus is a miracle worker. So I got Jesus' miracles, contemporary miracles, 50 saints obtained, Jesus' miracles, contemporary miracles, double-blind prayer. What do you do with these? I'll just throw another one out, just for fun. Shroud of Turin. Don't rule it out before you check it out. But I'm going to give you one more today. This last one. How do we know supernatural? What are we talking about here? Only the most supernatural of all, a resurrection. Okay, what's the main problem? Afterlife. Well, if you're a naturalist and you tilt the table and you say naturalism is true, there's two ways you can go on table tilters who try to rule out miracles. Here's the first one. Ask them how you prove naturalism's true. And that's what I'm going to ask those guys. How do you know naturalism is true? I get this response for some pretty major naturalists I've debated, big names. They'll say this. Well, you have to assume that for science to be true. Really? There's no reason to do it. Anthony Flew said one time in a debate, he said, just study the history of science. I said, the history of science mostly involves Christian scientists. Not Christian scientists, but Christian scientists. That's not going to solve it. It's not an assumption. Second point, you can't prove God doesn't exist. I said this to a very well-known atheist on a live dialogue, and he said, you can't prove a universal negative. I said, then why do you believe it? And at that point, I'm not being facetious, no answer. How do you prove naturalism? How do you prove God doesn't exist? And how dare you tip a table when you ask me for data? I've given you a load and you don't have any. Stop tipping the table. But here's my best comment. That's one way to go after it. Stop table tippers because they don't have data. But they require data. Next one. Near-death experiences. If you think they're jokes, you're not up on the research. One guy alone, he just recently retired from the University of Virginia School of Medicine, one person alone has published 100 peer-reviewed articles in medical and psychological journals, empirical journals. The latest book to come out, University of Missouri Press, it's a university press, not something you find in the checkout stand in the supermarket. University Press, and they estimate, the doctors in this book estimate, that 9 to 20 million Americans have had near-death experiences. That means, in a way, you could say, up to 20 million Americans have visited another world. They think, in their mind, they believe. Now, this lady in my church, let me back up. I asked a group last night, smarter than this group. Oh, let's just do it right here. Let this group speak for you. Probably trust these guys here, the ones that were down at that other universe I was at last night. How many of you, in your family or your closest friends, how many of you know of a case, just a reported case, someone who claims there's a case in your family or among your best friends where somebody has had a near-death experience or something equipped, there's a bunch of species of these, or something just like it. How many in your own family or among your best friends? Now, come on, you got to beat that group last night. There were 35 in a group half this size last night. Okay, so if you know of one, don't not put your hand up if you don't want to be counted. So I need your help. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, right there. 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. 16, all the way back to the back. 17, 18, 19. Come on, the goal's 35. 19, 20, 21. You got to be better than a university. 22, 23, 24, 25. I don't think you'll make it. 25. You're not going to get a minute ago. I didn't count you. 25. The other university, IUPUI, it's kind of part of yours anyway. And this one. 61. You go, that's just what people are claiming. Okay. How many does it take to prove this another realm? One good one. 65 shots just in these two rooms. You go, well, listen, I'm not just looking for a report. Anybody can report. Lie, cheat, be wrong, hallucination, heavy fever. Thought they saw something, and it really wasn't that person who died, it was Bigfoot. It could be a lot of things, but there's over 300 reported cases now, 20 million cases in the U.S., but over 300 are evidenced. What's an evidence? What's a evidence look like? Well, here's one. I told a group of faculty here this afternoon. In one case, a woman, I should tell you something. If you have a cardiac arrest today, there's different species. If you have a cardiac arrest with ventricular fibrillation, your heart stops working. That's what cardiac arrest means. An average of 14.4 seconds later, your brain stops working. 3 minutes later, your brain stem stops. Now, brain stem doesn't even do 2+2. Brain stem just means there's life somewhere in your body. 5 minutes after the fact, if you had a cardiac arrest, nothing major is working. Now, you know what's funny at this point? Skeptics will go, that's just if you believe in machines. You know, it's really funny. You believed those machines a week ago. You put people in the ground according to those machines a week ago. And now you're saying it's only with the machines. Say, why don't we keep everybody out of the ground until they stay, okay? And then we'll put them in the ground. I mean, come on. Use the same kind of reasoning that we use for other things. So cardiac arrest plus 3 minutes is a very evidential state. And there's a lady, cardiac arrest, she's up above her body. She says, I have obsessive compulsive disorder. And I looked down on top of a piece of metal box, medical contents. And on top, if you've ever seen these, they had a riveted number on top of the box. You couldn't see it from the ground. I looked down on it, and when she came to, she got the nurse, and she goes, write this number down. 12 digits. 126792, whatever. My TA, as many of you, he's a PhD candidate. Many of you know, you guys have med figures in your You know the old saying, if you want to work on your phone, you can call the youngest member of your family. We always call my 13-year-old grandson. Mm-hmm. All right, you can find this, but when he came to, he called the nurse and he said, write this number down, my TA found a way to contact her. He got the nurse. Tell me about this. What state was she in? Is this a true story? Did you write down the 12 numbers? Was she right? Is there any chance she missed one of them? And he got all the data from her. That's published anyway. But there could be a slip up, right? How did she know? What's the chance of getting 12 consecutive numbers? Well, somebody could lie. Really, but this thing is above what anybody could have seen in the room. That's just one example. I can give you other examples. Blind people who don't see before and after, but they saw it during the experience, and it's veridical, they report it, it happened, and they don't see it again. Healthy people who got sucked into it, if you want to say it that way, and they report what they saw. Here's an actual case. Five people were around grandma's bed, grandma or mom, whoever you are in the family, and grandma's in bad shape. They call all the family. They look over, her head's still on the pillow. This is reported by a medical doctor, by the way. Her head's still on the pillow, but what looks like her spirit comes up. I've left one thing out. Just before she came off the pillow, there was an orb, a light orb in the middle of the room. Five people, healthy people, sitting there, and here's how they were communicating. Everyone's going, yeah, they see this light. Grandma raises up. Looks like she lifts out of her body. The orb elongates into a tunnel. She goes into it. All five are watching her go up. By the way, before she entered, she had an ecstatic look on her face. She was happy. All five watched her until the chute closed. Grandma's body's dead on the bed. Say what you want. Say, I think I saw that in Twilight Zone last week. Okay, cool. These things have been written up in medical journals. They make them right. But if you're going to tip a table without evidence, how dare you talk, let me talk about this with evidence. And you won't be talking about double-blind prayer, current miracles, Jesus' miracles, etc. And if near-death experiences are correct and they're affecting the polls, on what people believe. It could be an afterlife. What's significant about resurrection? Afterlife. NDEs and resurrection happen in the same realm. Afterlife. And you're telling me I can't put this in medicine? I mean, as evidence, but I'm going to believe your view without any gain at all? I'm sorry. The world's crumbling on naturalists who think there's no other reports. And I'll end with this. Oy, Matt, let's see if there's a few other questions. But briefly, I had one of John's colleagues, is a PhD student of mine at Liberty. Her name is Lori. She works on the campus, University of New Hampshire. And she made a great comment in class last week. She goes, we don't have to convince the naturalists they're wrong. I'm dead serious, this sounds horrible. Here's what she said. She's about 35, 38, I don't know. She said, we don't have to wait till the naturalist professors on campus die. I mean, we don't have to wait till they're gone. They're all going to die. And the next generation, you folks, you younger ones here, next generation, according to the polls, you are not naturalists. You believe there's all kinds of phenomena in the world that are true. You'll be the next professors. And guess what? We won't have to tip the table from the beginning. So if you start allowing data because you think there's evidence for all the things I've mentioned, this is a new world. It's a new world. And there's a world where the last thing you can rule out is life after death. You tell me why I shouldn't believe these things. And I try to be real careful with the data. You can think something I said is a joke, that's fine. But you have to explain it all. All right. A long explanation. It's a short question. But it's not just your question. This is the other one I wanted to answer. Concerning what about people who say, yeah, but there's one problem. You expect us to believe in the supernatural. Now I'm going to say, why not? And what do you have to oppose it? Nothing? Okay, I thought so. Okay, next. Listen, if you guys have to go, that's absolutely fine. I have an hour and 15-minute drive back to the hotel, so if you want to go, if you guys want to listen to the replay of the Philadelphia game. Okay.
So even if the natural realm exists,
Good spread.
Yeah. And so how do we then say that these other things are more improbable? Like you mentioned hallucination plus, say, then Peter deluded the others. Right, so that's a very rare case. But then how do we say that the resurrection then, I guess, matches that?
Never put words in your mouth, but if you got this from Anthony Flew, or whether you knew it came from her or not, this is called his natural miracle objection. It's probably the most potent objection to miracles. What would you say to somebody who says, just what I just said. We got good evidence for all this, good evidence for resurrection. He said, why? Thank you, it's group hallucinations. And you say, there are no such things. And he says, there are no such thing as resurrections either. Is that what you mean?
Basically, yeah.
Okay, it's called natural miracle objection. I have two comebacks. One I just answered. The problem is he's rejecting mine, for which I have a bunch of data, for his, for which we have no data. So he's still playing the naturalistic game. He's still saying there's no evidence for these things. I've got a lot. Jesus' miracles, current miracles, double blind prayer, the only two that have worked, near-death experiences in the realm of life, resurrection of Jesus. Now, what was your... Now, I know, you know, this may or may... I don't know what your beliefs are, but I go, now, what was your evidence for naturalism again?
Yes.
That's the problem. I have all this, and you want to be considered... Not you, but your objector wants to be considered in the same boat. We've got no data. That's one. Here's my other answer. It is not one group hallucination will not get you over the hump. Early Christianity, if you believe the earliest evidences, you don't need resurrection proclamation followed by no group hallucinations because there's one, because there's a group appearance of Jesus. Here's what the Christians have. All the data for all this, all the data for contemporary miracles, and it's not one group hallucination. You don't have to do a miraculous, it's this way, it's not a real miracle. I'll take the group hallucination, you take resurrection, my miracle is less miraculous. Okay, here's my response. Maybe, if it's one group hallucination. But there are eight group appearances in the New Testament, attested. Here's what you need for your theory. No others in the world, except for these eight. And now the only person who's ever seen a group hallucination is Jesus' followers. I go, golly, that's what the New Testament reports. The only one this happened to is Jesus. But I still keep the middle one. Tony Flew was a naturalist when he gave that objection. If there's no evidence for naturalism, he can't even get started. And what do you do with near-death experiences? If you think of the evidence for naturalism, come up after. I'm being facetious. Yes.
I'd be interested in hearing if anyone in objecting to the case you've presented to us tonight has tried to cite Occam's razor as an objection, and if so, how would you answer?
Okay, so Occam's razor says the simplest explanation is usually the right explanation. But don't forget, Occam's razor says simplest is usually the right one when all other things are equal. If there's no evidence for naturalism, all things aren't equal. We have a mountain of evidence on one side, nothing on the other side, and you can't bring Occam in if there's not roughly evidential cases. But what's the alternative case against? I mean, you need empirical data, and you need to say, wow, this is a tie game going in overtime. Rather than going overtime, we're going to let Occam's razor decide it, and the simplest explanation is the best one, but you haven't, nobody scored points on the other side. Can't go in overtime if there's no score unless it's 0-0. But on the theist side, with the, like again, I don't want to keep just repeating all this, but the miracles of Jesus, current day miracles, double-blind prayer, near-death experiences, what do you do, Shroud of Turin, I mentioned it briefly, resurrection of Jesus, that's a lot of touchdowns. What touchdowns are the naturalist scoring to make this go into overtime in order to use my metaphor, in order to use Occam's razor? They're not similar cases. It's all nothing, And I'm not going to punt to Occam's razor if the other side doesn't have some data to play this game. To use a stupid illustration, I don't know anything about poker. But you don't let somebody come sit down at the table who has $10 in his pocket and wants to play a high-stakes, multi-million dollar. He doesn't have it. He's not putting up. And if someone doesn't have the data to get there to put the evidence on the table, you can't use Occam's razor. He's going, I can play poker just like the rest of you. Yeah, but stupid, you got $10. Nobody wants you to play and lose their million. Okay. What's on the other side to oppose the data for resurrection? Occam's razor is no good if you don't have... Occam's razor is not a standalone test. Yes?
So, can you talk a little bit about what the contemporary views of Jewish people were on resurrection and the afterlife in the time of Jesus?
Contemporary view of Jewish people?
Yeah.
Today or first century?
In the time of Jesus.
Sorry?
In the time of Jesus.
Time of Jesus, Jewish view of resurrection. Jews had a number of views of resurrection. By far the predominant one, the resurrection of the body. Tom Wright, I mean, I kind of say this teasingly, but it's a true statement. Tom Wright has maybe written the longest word study in history. His words for the Jewish concept of resurrection, his study is 550 pages long at the median of two words, Gnosticism and Nigero. And his thesis, some people think he's a little strict with this, but his thesis is, if you're a Jew, if you're a Christian, if you're a pagan, it's irrelevant. If you use the words Gnosticism, resurrection, Nigero, raised, if you use those terms, you mean bodily. And someone goes, that's not true. Greeks had ghosts. Well, Jews had ghosts. Look at the Witch of Endor or whatever you count that is. Jews had those concepts too. And Tom would go, that's not what I'm saying. They don't use the words Gnosticism and Nigero for the Witch of Endor or ghosts or Bigfoot or whatever. So whenever they use the words Gnosticism and Nigero, they always and only meant bodily. So yes, there were different views. But the predominant words are Gnosis and Nigero, their bodily terms. And Tom Wright says from before Christ up until the time of the Gnostics, about 180 AD, the view, there are other views, but by far, not for Gnosis and Nigero, just other views of afterlife. But that when you use Gnosis and Nigero, they're always and only resurrection of the body. Having said that, I don't want to confuse anybody. The predominant Christian view is at the intermediate state, back to the case where grandma appears to have gone up the, in between grandma dying and the end of time, second coming or whatever you want to use, up until then she's bodiless. And after that time she's re-embodied. Tom Wright calls it life after death. The New Testament teaches two stages, disembodied followed by re-embodied. And you can study it, I mean, if you want to spend 550 pages, but it's brilliant. Now, I think a lot of reviewers said, yeah, I think I can use an example here. It's kind of an exception. This was kind of an exception. We can't say 100%, but yeah, Tom's right 98% of the time. So I guess if that's your conclusion, Tom's right 98% of the time. It's a very impressive study.
Sometimes I read where you all talk about evidence for the empty tomb.
Yeah.
And one of the arguments is that Christianity started in Jerusalem, and therefore the body must have been missing, because if the body were around, that was, the authorities would have displayed it and it would have ended Christianity.
That's one way it's said.
Okay.
Yeah, anyway, go ahead, yes.
Okay. Well, my question is, How does the decomposing of the
body affect that argument? Good question. Our question is, first of all, let me just add one more. How many evidence have been into? I don't know if I gave you a number when I said this earlier. I know of 23 critical arguments for the empty tomb. Critical, I mean the way critical scholars argue. 23. Then why is it not the minimum facts? Because I don't have 95% acceptance. I have about 75% acceptance. That's a huge comeback from when I was in grad school. Okay. And I say the two best reasons are the women are used and the preaching is in Jerusalem. Let me explain both those real quickly. The women are witnesses. We think of books being written and we might think, well, let's take my city, Lynchburg, Virginia, your city, is this Lafayette or West Lafayette? West Lafayette. Okay, Indiana. I'm from Detroit, let's say that, and Seattle, Washington. Four places. We think of books being written and quickly put on the internet, and like anybody could have used anybody because you beat me on the internet by 4 days, so I could have gotten it before. But it wasn't like that in the early church. People are writing the four gospels, the four geographical positions around the Mediterranean. So far, so good for Virginia, Indiana, Michigan, and Seattle. So far, so good. But they couldn't get each other's data. So the first reason is, and this impresses skeptics the most, if you're trying to make a case for resurrection, you won't put your best foot forward, no offense, ladies, why use women? Now, it's not true that a woman couldn't testify in court of law in the first century. She could. But there was an inverse relation between you being a woman, how important the testimony is, and is there a man? Okay, a lot of prejudice. So, that prejudice works in favor of Christians here. If four people are writing the story around the Mediterranean, not copying off each other, oftentimes the other gospel, the other two, Matthew and Luke, most popular theory they use Mark, but not in these accounts. Long story. So why did all four pick the women if they're not witnesses? Now follow this with me. And Luke and John, two men go to the tomb, Peter and John. Why not just start your study with two men went to the tomb, Peter and John? You're not lying. It's the truth. Why give the example of the women? You're shooting yourself in the foot. And four out of four? Why'd you do it? Really simple. It's true. That's what happened. That's why critics take the women's testimony. And I told the faculty today, it's not just the women reported the empty tomb. Think of the following. The men ran away, only John's present. Other than that, just the women still had enough guts to be at the cross. Except for two obscure disciples, Joseph and Nicodemus, only women were present at the burial. Only the women go to the tomb first on Sunday morning. And let's add the last one, the women saw Jesus first. Isn't that kind of cool? Jesus saying the last will be first, the first last. Kind of like a walking parable. Okay, so you have and then you have Jerusalem. Now, common comeback is your question. Yeah, but even according to your own book, Acts, they didn't start preaching for 50 days. In 50 days, there could have been a body there, and they would know because the body would decompose. Doesn't work. Let me tell you why. First of all, Michael Cohn and I have both interviewed pathologists. They say that in a Middle Eastern spring climate, the body would not have decomposed beyond recognition in 50 days. Don't forget, even if facial features were messed up, there's still the matter of the holes in four places and a big one here. You can tell where wounds are and otherwise not very successfully identified body. Here's the big problem. The New Testament, the apostles did not say, the tomb is empty. Oh, excuse me, there's a body there, but none of you can tell who it is. They said, the tomb is empty. If you find a body, no matter who it is, the disciples lose. They said, there's no body there. Someone says, here's a body. Disciples lose. It's only if the tomb is totally empty that they win. So, if they're making this up, go preach it in Alexandria. Go preach it in Rome. Go preach it in Ephesus. Go preach it in Athens. But don't preach it in Jerusalem because you're stupid. Somebody can check it out on an hour's walk. So, that's a comeback. It's not going to work on decomposition, but the worst thing is nobody can be there. And you'll be able to continue your message. And why wouldn't the Jewish leaders have done that instead of, don't talk about him again. How about, there's a body, boys. Okay, this might be the last one. You better think about it. Otherwise, you're going to have the gospels aren't coming up.
Just on that point, the Jewish leaders, the ones that say that they stole the body. They
if they stole the body. What about it?
I'm saying, you know, just continuing with what you were saying, didn't the Jewish leaders tell the Romans to spread the word that the body was stolen in prison?
So and we have two sources that were still being
they
spread.
Know it was empty.
Yeah, that's a good point. They except most critics don't like that move because it's told only in Matthew. So I would never use it because I've only got one source for it. It fails my own test. Now, you guys have to understand, when I say I'm only using best case scenarios, that doesn't mean the rest is false. That just means the rest isn't as well derived. Certainly could be garbage there. I'm just saying I can't include it in one of my facts because it's hardly you'll hardly find a critic at all who will. But you're right, it was spread around in Matthew. It was repeated later by Justin the Martyrs, repeated later by Clement of Alexandria. Okay, Mr. Gospel. Oh, he did.
All right, thank you very much. You've been a very engaging audience. Can we have one last round of applause?